In this video, I'm going to talk about Broadway in and after the 1960s. Broadway is a term that refers to theater production in the United States in a very unique way, but what does it mean? And some of the things that happened in Broadway in the 1960s and in subsequent decade are extremely important in understanding the total evolution of contemporary theater since that time. So first of all, what and where is Broadway? Well, Broadway is a very long street in the borough of Manhattan in New York City. It begins at the very bottom of the island of Manhattan and goes north up through the entire island, well into the Bronx, as you can see on the map. And when we look at where the theaters are located on Broadway, we'll see that it's only a very, very small section of Broadway that consists of the theaters that we refer to when we talk about Broadway in this large sense. The theater district consists of about four square blocks between 42nd Avenue and about 48th Avenue in Manhattan, Midtown Manhattan, where Broadway intersects those streets. And you have a very dense congregation of theaters that represent the most powerful concentration of theatrical resources in the United States. When we talk about Broadway, we use that as a kind of reference point for talking about other kinds of theater. So in relation to the theaters of New York, we speak of Broadway, but we also speak of off-Broadway and then off-Broadway. So those terms, all measured in relation to Broadway, have a special significance for theater in New York. And remember that New York has the largest investment in theater culture of any city in the United States, by far. So the way in which the theater culture in New York operates is significant to understanding the larger dimension of theater in the United States. Off-Broadway refers to professional theaters that operate throughout New York City, and there are many, but which are not located in this theater district intersected by Broadway between 42nd Street and 48th Street. And many serious plays happen off-Broadway throughout the borough of Manhattan, and generally the theaters are there on that island only and not elsewhere in the city. And then off-Broadway refers to many little theaters, some of which are semi-professional, and many others are professional, but they are on a smaller scale. Off-Broadway and off-Broadway have definitions largely regulated by agreements with the city of New York, contracts with unions, and agreements with organizations like Actors Equity and the size, how many seats they can have in the theater. So off-Broadway tends to refer to professional theaters that don't operate entirely within the theater district, but observe the professional standards expected of theater on Broadway. Off-Broadway refers to a more improvised set of theater theaters and productions that involve semi-professional, professional performers, smaller audiences. It's much more experimental in many ways. The thing to remember about off-Broadway and off-Broadway is that shows migrate, if they are successful, from off-Broadway to off-Broadway to Broadway, so that the city has developed this elaborate system for connecting all the theaters within it to a larger cultural identity as the theater capital of the United States. Now, musicals have defined perception of Broadway for many decades, since the 1950s. These are the largest productions that the theater in the United States seems to stage in terms of resources. The 1950s was a golden age of musicals, according to many people who have studied the musicals. And it's difficult to argue the point, since so many of the wonderful shows, musicals, emerged at that time, representing a huge spirit of optimism and prosperity in the United States after World War II. One can name many, many musicals, beginning with Oklahoma in 1943, in South Pacific in 1945, Carousel, Pajama Game, Damn Yankees, Bells Are Ringing, so many shows, Pal Joey, they all came into American culture at a time when the United States was enjoying immense prosperity, and the musicals brought a message that basically you can sing and dance your way out of any problem, and they had a lot of excellent memorable music and dance numbers to support that spirit of optimism. By the 1960s, however, the country as a whole began to experience deepening disillusionment with the values of the 1950s. And that spirit of optimism required greater and greater energy to sustain it, you might say. But in any case, in the 1960s, the musicals and Broadway had to restructure and innovate. The 60s was a time of great failure for many shows on Broadway, as many audiences began to become more demanding and expect more intense experiences from the theater. The cost of producing shows on Broadway in the 1960s escalated, and at the same time, the unique system for creating musicals went into decline when you had teams of composers and librettists and lyricists producing all those wonderful musicals from the 1950s. You also had kind of educational system for incubating and developing the talent to create those musicals. And those friendships and partnerships and teams that produced those musicals actually started their work back in the 1920s and the 30s and into the 40s. And it was built around this special relation that people had that was kind of informal and built around apprenticeships and knowing people who fostered and encouraged talent. But by the 1960s, those teams were getting old and they didn't really have a way of perpetuating their legacy, and it was much more difficult to sustain the talent that went into creating the musicals, as had been the case in the 1950s. At the same time, as I said before, audiences sought more powerful experiences from the theater as ticket prices rose, and they rose significantly in order to sustain the theaters on Broadway, and indeed many theaters closed in the theater district. They couldn't sustain themselves with the shows they were producing. So by the end of the, or into the 1960s, and by the end of the 1960s, successful musicals tackled more serious themes than in the past. And sometimes they did not project a spirit of optimism, but more of a spirit of disillusionment and critical perspective. Musicals also chose non-American context for their stories, which was unprecedented to a large extent in musicals previous to the 60s. and musicals in the 60s introduced music and dance forms that previously had not belonged to the musical. So in my next video, I want to talk about some of the examples of the new shows that emerged in the 1960s and beyond in response to the changes that took place in the 1960s. Okay, so we get that little video out.